Businesses do not operate in isolation. They are very dependent on suppliers, customers, and partners to accomplish their objectives and do well over the long term. Not only do businesses have their own value chain or supply chain, they are embedded in a business network or ecosystem. Some companies are better at managing their business relationships than others. In this video, we are going to discuss the important topic of how to manage business partnerships, alliances, and customer relationships. This video complements the material in Chapter 5 of our textbook, Marketing of High Technology Products and Innovations. We will begin by looking at different types of partnerships within a business network, then get into how to select the right partners, how to set up the structure of the agreement, and how to manage a partner portfolio. Finally, we will touch upon some important issues in customer relationship management. Here is a simplified look at Google's business network or ecosystem for the Android operating system. There are different stakeholders in this network: the handset or tablet manufacturers, the app developers, freelancers who might enhance the open source code of Android, and consumers like us who may use the OS on our handsets or tablets. Clearly, there are differences in the interactions that Google has with its various partners. The relationship with the freelancers is probably arm's length, which means Google really doesn't interact with them much. Freelancers are free to enhance the code in Android, provided they follow the licensing agreement. The relationship with the app developers is likely to be closer than with the freelancers, because there is more give and take in these relationships. We can call these business partnerships between Google and its app developers. Google Play is the distribution platform that Google provides to app developers, and apps provide considerable value to Android users. The relationship with the handset manufacturers, for example Samsung, is the most strategic and may be called a strategic alliance. Every time Samsung comes up with a new handset or Google comes up with a new version of Android, the two companies have to share information on product development and market launch and coordinate their activities through written plans and documents. More than arm's length relationships and business partnerships, strategic alliances are long-term cooperative agreements between independent companies for specific business initiatives. The independence of the companies in the partnership is important. This is what distinguishes partnerships or alliances from acquisitions and mergers. There are two kinds of partnerships a focal firm could consider. You have vertical partnerships along the value chain or supply chain with suppliers, distributors, and customers. If you consider Apple as the focal firm, it has vertical partnerships with suppliers like Foxconn that do contract manufacturing of the iPhone in China. It has distribution partnerships with carriers or telecom service operators like Verizon in the US, Telia Sonera in Europe, and Airtel in India. Thus, outsourcing is a special case of a vertical partnership where important business functions are contracted out to a supplier or distributor. Apple also has horizontal or lateral partnerships with companies that have their own vertical chains. Complementers are companies whose products and services add value to to the customers of the focal firm. Third-party developers like Facebook with its mobile app and Rovio with its popular Angry Birds game enhance the value of the iPhone to its customers, so they are called complementors. Less frequent, but not unusual, are partnerships that Apple may have with competitors like Microsoft. Although Apple and Microsoft compete vigorously in the handset and tablet market, Apple still needs Microsoft to make apps like Office 365 available on the Mac platform. When a company cooperates with a competitor, this is called coopetition, which is a cut and merge of two words, cooperation and competition. The popular press also refers to such partners as frenemies, which is a cut and merge of the words friends and enemies. Here is a question for you all. As a general rule, which kind of partnerships are a bigger challenge for focal firms, vertical or horizontal, and why? Another question. Can you come up with your own real example of a partnership to illustrate the concept of frenemy? Let's move on to partner selection issues. In the normal course of business, you come across companies that do interesting work, that may have products that add value to your customers, or have strengths to make up for your weaknesses. It is these companies that you contact and invite for discussions on possible cooperation. In a first meeting, each company may lay out its vision for the industry and outline its strategy with regard to realizing that vision. If there is compatibility in vision and strategy, then you explore compatibility in values and culture. It is best to partner with companies with whom you have prior history of business relations. You may also want to select companies of similar size to ensure interdependence. However, if you must partner with companies of unequal size and without any prior history, make sure you take the time to get to know them well before signing an agreement. There are so many reasons why companies choose to partner. Here is a long list of those reasons. A specific partnership being considered may only have a subset of these. These considerations establish the basis of complementarity and interdependence. As an example, Apple signed a distribution partnership with China Mobile for the iPhone in 2014. This greatly expands Apple's access to the China market because China Mobile has the largest carrier network there. In 2010, Toyota agreed to invest $50 million in Tesla, the electric car company. In return, Toyota got access to Tesla's know-how and lithium-ion battery pack for the electric version of the RAV4. Small biotech companies have strengths in drug development, but they like to partner with large pharmaceutical companies that have strengths in regulatory management, marketing and distribution. GlaxoSmithKline, the global pharmaceutical company, is particularly good at striking partnerships with innovative biotech startups and helping them get through clinical trials and market launch. Of course, partnering is not without risks, because when you involve a partner in a project, you give up some autonomy and control. Managing across company boundaries introduces complexity into the project, because now you have to keep the partner's employees motivated and on track to meet partnership objectives. There have been some visible partnership failures. Going back to the late 1980s, Microsoft and IBM went their separate ways after many years of successful partnership between Microsoft operating system and the IBM PC. Amazon and Toys R Us have taken each other to court over breach of their contractual partnership agreement. Lately, the patent wars between Apple and Samsung have affected their business partnerships as Apple tries to find alternatives to Samsung, which is one of their biggest suppliers of component chips and flash memory. The next topic is governance. Governance is the term used to denote how the relationship between partners is to be governed in the future. It is reflected in the agreement negotiated at the outset, as well as the ongoing patterns of interaction between partners. If a partnership or alliance is important, the parties should take the time to negotiate a formal agreement that lays out the scope of work, tasks and responsibilities, resources required, duration, coordination mechanisms, and other terms and conditions. In addition to a contract, if one company makes a minority equity investment in the partner, this acts as a self-imposed constraint on exploiting the partner. For example, Toyota, by investing $50 million in Tesla, is signaling to the smaller company that it will not hurt it, because that action would decrease the value of its own stock holding. The most complex form of agreement structure is the joint venture or JV, where two or more partners decide to form a new company with its own mission, management, and resources. For many years, Nokia and Siemens had a 50-50 joint venture called Nokia Siemens Networks to provide telecommunications equipment and infrastructure services to large enterprises. However, the joint venture ended in 2013 with Nokia buying out Siemens's 50% share. Now, the company, which is no longer a joint venture, is called Nokia Solutions and Networks. Alliances and partnerships have more flexibility to deal with environmental uncertainty as compared to mergers and acquisitions, in the sense that if things don't work out between partners, they can call it quits and go their separate ways. There are three ways of setting up an alliance agreement between partners. Contracts are the most flexible to deal with uncertainty and the easiest to exit if things don't work out between partners. Minority equity investments are intermediate in flexibility and ease of exit. Joint ventures have the least flexibility and are the most difficult to exit, because the existing company has to wind up and liquidate its physical assets and terminate its existing employees. Clearly, the complexity of the agreement increases as you go from contract to minority equity investment to joint venture. So, more structured or more complex agreements are required under the following conditions. When there are more investments in relationship-specific assets. Relationship-specific investments are those that have no value outside the relationship. For example, Panasonic and Tesla are partnering to build a battery manufacturing plant in USA to build lithium-ion batteries for Tesla's electric cars. Those batteries are so specifically customized for Tesla that any investments that Panasonic makes in the plant will not have any market value outside the relationship. So, if the partnership doesn't work out, Panasonic will have to write off all its investments as losses. More complex agreements are required when the companies have no prior business ties, when they want to have an alliance for a longer duration, or when the partnership is of a higher strategic importance. Then these complex agreements provide safeguards. They safeguard the interests of the partners, and the chances of success increase. After setting up and implementing a partnership agreement for a while, you may find that the original contract needs to be adapted. Why? It may be that the original agreement was not the right one to begin with. It may have been too simple or too complex and needs to be adjusted. Relationship-specific investments by one or more partners may have increased over time and call for more safeguards in the agreement. There may be major changes in the business environment, or the partner's strategy may have changed, and these require also contract renegotiations and adaptations. So, just because an agreement is structured at the outset doesn't mean that it may not need to be tweaked over time. Now, there are two models of or styles of managing interactions between partners. Unilateral is where everyone, it's obvious to everyone that one party is more powerful and has the authority to make decisions. So, there are many companies that can illustrate this. Dell is notoriously feared by its suppliers because it is unilateral. It just asks for lower prices every year. That's a unilateral style of management. Bilateral is where there are mutual expectations of behavior based on trust, communication, and commitment. When there is a lot of environmental uncertainty and the scope of work is complex, then bilateral interactions may be better than unilateral interactions. How do you build trust with a partner with whom you have no prior history and perhaps no cultural compatibility? Don't rush into signing any agreements. Take the time to get to know key individuals and build interpersonal trust. That can later lead to interorganizational trust. This should be part of the due diligence and negotiation process that could take months or years. All of that is time well spent when you have no knowledge of the partner. Start with a limited scope of work and expand this over time as you build trust with the partner. Trust will contribute to better information sharing and communication, a willingness to share resources, and will result in a sense of mutual benefit for all the partners. Bilateral interactions need both trust and commitment. What is commitment? It's the desire to continue the relationship in the future, and it is demonstrated by investments that one partner makes in the relationship, very customized, tailored investments that have no market value outside the relationship. These signal commitments. And The reason why commitment is so important is committed partners are less likely to exploit or sabotage the relationship. Now we get to discussing how to manage a partner portfolio. A company may have many partners in their network. Some are more strategic, some are less. So how does one allocate management time and resources to managing all this diverse portfolio of partners? There are three simple steps. First, analyze what value you are contributing to each partner. Second, classify partners based on your value to them. And then, allocate resources and manage relationships according to priority. So, how do you try to make assessments of your value to key partners? Value for which they would be willing to pay good money. For each partner in your portfolio, you can ask, what is my current value contribution to this partner? Let's illustrate the analysis from the point of view of a product supplier to a business customer. The lowest possible value contribution is that supplier provides a better quality product or a better price that might reduce direct costs or both. The next level of value is to enhance the product with service. Be responsive when the customer asks for information. Provide well-trained sales and service personnel who interact well with the customer. The service levels may be so good that it reduces the customer's costs of maintaining the relationship. Finally, if you are a supplier that can provide your customer with know-how, both strategic and operational, in addition to product and service, then you can become quite indispensable to the customer. Take the example of IBM. Although IBM still makes products like semiconductors and servers and has a reputation for excellent service, it is really well known for its consulting services that become indispensable to business customers. When Airtel wanted to launch its mobile telecom service in India, it partnered with IBM to provide the platform and infrastructure for all its network services. Other than marketing, sales and billing, most of the business functions were outsourced by Airtel to IBM, and it turned out to work quite well. So once you make these assessments of value, you can classify partners according to how valuable you are to them. It is very important, however, that your value be assessed objectively from the partner's point of view. If you have inflated assessments of your value contributions that the customer doesn't agree with, then you have a problem and this analysis will not work. So, although you are assessing your value contributions to the partner, it should be a mirror image of what the partner is willing to pay for that value. So, we do an ABC analysis. The C level is where you contribute only the core value offering to the partner. This is the product quality or reduction of direct costs. In the B level, those are the partners to whom you offer both the core product as well as enhanced service support. And finally, there are the A level partners whom you offer core offering plus service plus know-how, and those are your best customers. So, we call these A-level partnerships strategic alliances. For a really important strategic alliance, You might develop an annual business plan or marketing plan and have all the parties buy into the plan and have all the parties review results frequently, usually every quarter. If you find it is getting difficult to schedule these review meetings, it means the alliance may have dropped in importance for one of the partners. You need to have both an operational alliance manager for day-to-day activities as well as a top management executive champion on each side that the alliance managers could turn to for escalating problems or issues. And of course, these A-level strategic alliances need to be safeguarded by more structured agreements like joint ventures or minority equity investments. And they're likely to involve bilateral interactions based on trust, communication, and commitment. After the A-level partners, the next in priority are the B-level bread and butter partnerships. How to get the most out of these partners? Broaden and deepen operational linkages between personnel. The broader and deeper these linkages, the more business opportunities they could surface. These contracts are usually long-term in nature, multi-years, high dollar value, and once they're implemented, you want to have operational review meetings usually every quarter, and based on those reviews, ongoing negotiation and adjustments will need to be made. The C-level business relationships probably make up the largest category of all the three levels of partners. By proper classification of partnerships, according to your value contributions and proper investment in appropriate governance, you will get the most returns from your partner portfolio. So the C-level relationships, all they need is a simple contract defining what are the benefits and responsibilities, and there's little need for safeguards. Many organizations have a team for managing partnerships and alliances, and this team maintains a database of partners and records the progress you're making with each for future partnering opportunities, creating some kind of institutional memory for alliances and partnerships. An organization can develop a partnering competence and capability over time. Organizations develop reputations for partnering in the marketplace. For example, Microsoft and Walmart don't have a very great reputation for partnering, whereas Cisco and IBM and GlaxoSmithKline have more positive reputations for partnering. Our final topic in this session is customer relationship management, and it starts with the recognition that the purpose of marketing is to attract new customers, retain existing customers, and grow existing customers, all in a profitable way for the company. So, a really important concept in trying to improve the quality of customer relationship management is this idea of customer lifetime value. Here is a chart that shows for a hypothetical customer how much profit does a company earn in year 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. The purple bar on the negative side in year 1 is the acquisition cost of a customer. The red bars show how much the customer is contributing to the company's profits over time. And the little yellow bars show the customer, in addition to the basic offering on the red bar, whether you're able to cross-sell and upsell them to buy other products from the company. And then finally, the blue bar, the blue part of the bar, shows that there is some indirect contribution of this customer from referrals, because they're telling their friends and neighbors about it, and they might also come and join your company. So the idea of the customer lifetime value is, if marketeers can estimate this, it helps them to prioritize which segments to target. Let's take the example of a young car buyer buying his or her first car at age 22. When they get their first job, they may just buy an entry-level compact or economy car for $10,000. But as they do better in their professional careers and they grow their families, they may come back several times to buy from the same manufacturer if there's brand loyalty. The lifetime value of a first-time auto buyer then is not $10,000, but maybe $300,000 over 40 or 50 years. And marketeers want to go after the high LTV customers. Now we can use the LTV concept for both acquisition as well as retention. Here is a framework that tells a marketeer how aggressive do you want to be with regard to your acquisition strategy for several segments. If you can segment your customers by lifetime value and acquisition cost, then this gives you some guidance on how much to invest in acquiring customers. The full throttle is the most attractive segment due to high LTV and also low acquisition cost. So you should go after them with full marketing support. Then come the pay-as-you-go customers. In telecom services, the full throttle would be postpaid subscribers, and the pay-as-you-go would be prepaid customers. You don't do aggressive acquisition marketing for the lower two segments. If there are a range of customers in the slingshot segment, aim for those who have relatively higher LTV and relatively lower acquisition cost than others. Go after them selectively. And on the lower left, don't target these at all. Let them walk in if they like. This way, you're allocating your limited marketing resources and effort to maximize the returns in terms of customer acquisition. And then, when you want to manage existing customers, in addition to profit, you consider their loyalty, or how long are you able to retain them as your customers. True friends are your best customers, so spend a lot on satisfying and retaining them. Maintain consistent communication and surprise and delight them from time to time. These are your A-level customers. Butterflies, satisfy them, maximize price and profit at every transaction, but don't spend a lot on marketing to them, because they are variety seeking, they flit from flower to flower. All you need to do is spread the marketing message of awareness and availability. Strangers, make no investment, maximize profit at every transaction. And barnacles, you want to divest these customers because they're clinging to you and they're not very profitable. So you might want to divest them if they're unprofitable altogether. But if they're not totally unprofitable, then you could restructure the relationships to reduce the cost of serving them. For example, barnacles are probably better served through a web channel instead of real salespeople. To summarize then, alliances and partnerships are particularly important in high-tech business environments because they offer flexibility to deal with environmental uncertainty and take on specific business opportunities through cooperation and shared risk. If there is a common thread here, it is that alliances, partnerships, and customer relationships have to be carefully managed. We have to analyze potential partners and customers in terms of value contributions, prioritize them, and then focus our marketing efforts on those that can offer us the most value. This concludes the video lecture on this topic. Hope you found it useful. Thanks for listening.